Welcome to Crime in Court. My name is Heather, and this is episode 55 of the Canton Cover-Up Commonwealth versus Karen Reed. We are going to go over a lot in this episode because I had another episode planned prior to this and something went wrong with the recording, so I'm kind of mixing them together. So it's going to be a little bit of a longer episode. We're going to go over the hearing that is today. So I have not watched it. I'm watching it like in real time, just, you know, a few minutes behind as I'm recording this for you guys for later tonight. And before we get started on watching this hearing, though, let me let you know what we're going to talk about in this episode. So first up, I've got a couple quick announcements, and we're going to go over the juror E affidavit, which I didn't get a chance to go over on my channel yet. And we're going to talk about some intimidation going on from Canton townies all around town and intimidation by some law enforcement maybe going on happening in Massachusetts. And then we're going to talk briefly a little bit, just kind of a refresher as to what Aiden's charges are, because I know a lot of people are newer coming into this. Aiden Turtle Boy Carney, Turtle Boy is his handle on YouTube and all of his social media. So Dr. Turtle Boy to all of you. he calls himself a doctor because he says if Jill Biden can call herself a doctor, he calls himself a doctor, which I don't know. She probably does have a doctorate degree. I don't know. But anyways, we've got a lot to cover, so let's get to it. I'm going to try to talk not as much as usual, just because, blah, 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 I don't want to take up too much time, so we can get through all these different topics. So first, I did want to go over, let me swap over here. So before we get into reading the affidavit here, the second supplemental affidavit from Alan Jackson, a quick announcement. Netflix has announced that they are making a three-part docuseries on this case, on Karen Reed, on John O'Keefe, Officer John O'Keefe, and how he lost his life on the lawn sometime, you know, that evening on 34 Fairview Road. So the documentary, I don't know who's behind it. I do know that Karen Reed's team is not behind it and Turtle Boy is not behind it. So there's a lot of people, I'm sure, that are interested in making documentaries, but this particular one, just so you know, don't get too excited because it's probably not going to be as reliable, I'm thinking, but that's just my opinion. I don't know how biased it might be towards her guilt or not, but we'll see. Maybe it's a good thing. We'll find out when it airs. I'm not sure when it's dropping, though, but that was recently announced. So let's get started with this supplemental affidavit by Alan Jackson in support of Karen Reed's motion to dismiss. But before we do, please hit the like button and make sure that you're subscribed so that you don't miss any future episodes on the Karen Reed case that I may do. I've gone through it from day one to here we are now at episode 59, and we've gone through all the court documents and analyzed a lot of the things that are wrong with this case. So here we are. We've had a mistrial, and we had a juror recently, where I left off with you guys, that we had a juror recently come forward as Juror Doe, and they feel threatened, and they believe that it's going to lead to some kind of physical altercation, and they kept going there in their affidavit that they wanted their names impounded because they were afraid for their safety physically. And I roll my eyes because there have been no physical altercations except from people from the anti-Karen Reed side towards Karen Reed supporters. And there are several incidents that we could list off. There's Tom CPU got pushed, and Turtle Boy's been assaulted by many people. And Jess Machado got assaulted by Grant Smith Ellis, I couldn't think of his name, and I'm sure there's more that I can't think of. There are more, definitely, but those are just a few. And that's just off the top of my head. And I have not heard one instance. Oh, and a turtle that was shot in the head and strung up by the neck was left on Turtle Boy's parents' front lawn 2 days after his mother passed away, by the way. So that's disgusting. And that's what these sociopaths are doing on the other side. So that's the vandalism and terrorism and things that are going on in the town of Canton right now, which we will get more into later on in this episode. My dog needs to hold on. All right, so she's comfy now. We're ready. All right, so let's read through this and go from there. So we've got the, like I said, this is the second motion, the second affidavit from Alan Jackson, because he's already done one for another juror. So here we go. This is now the fifth juror to come forward and say that they were all unanimous on counts one through, or one and three, sorry, counts one and three. They were unanimous that she was not guilty. So here is this fifth. Because there is a law in Massachusetts and the attorneys cannot reach out to the jurors have to come to them. So this is an affidavit sworn by Alan Jackson because he can't actually get the juror to sign an affidavit yet. Like they need special permission from the court to actually seek out contact with these jurors. So for these purposes, his word has to be taken in good faith. And I'm just going to skip number one because that just says he's practicing and representing Karen. Number two, on Wednesday, July 17th, 2024, I, Alan Jackson, was contacted by juror E. So that is number five. Mambo number five. Juror number five. True name and identity withheld to maintain anonymity based on my conversation with juror E and that juror's physical description of himself or herself, where that juror was seated, and that juror's name and occupation, which was also disclosed during the voir dire process. I was able to positively identify juror E as a seated deliberating juror in the trial of this matter. So they actually were in the deliberation room. This was one of the individuals that their vote counted. So it matters what they're saying here. So number three, juror E stated that he or she decided to contact me to provide information about the results of the jury's decision making following deliberations. Number four, juror E explained that the jury was unanimous on one and three that Karen Reed was not guilty of those charges. Number five, juror E went on to state that the only count on which the jury was deadlocked was in relation to the lower charges, count two. So we'll break that down in a minute. So keep that thought. So counts one and three, unanimously not guilty. The lower charges on count two, they were confused about, or deadlocked about, I should say. And Alan Jackson says, I took the phrase lower charges to mean the included offenses, the lesser included offenses associated with count two. Number six, juror E indicated that he or she was happy to provide such information but wished to remain publicly anonymous. The foregoing is true and correct to the best of my knowledge and belief. Under the penalty of perjury, under the laws of three government entities, the United States, the state of California, and the government or the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So that's three government entities that he is swearing that this is the truth. So, anyone who wants to say he's a liar, that's three separate entities that he would have to go against in if he had to prove that he was lying or whatever. Or, yeah, they'd have to prove he was lying. So, he's not lying. They can't lie on these. They can spin things. They can, that's what a lot of lawyers do is spin stuff. But when you have the facts and the evidence on your side, you don't have to do a whole lot of spinning here. All right, so let me switch over to this page I wanted to show you. So Christina Rex, she's the one that did the Paul O'Keefe interview that was really like a puff piece, and it was very bad. But she tweeted on X today, this morning, breaking, I just spoke with a deliberating juror from the Karen Reed trial. This juror independently confirmed to me that the jury was unanimous for acquittal on charges 1 and 3, second degree homicide and leaving the scene. So those are the two charges that they said not guilty on. And this could be one of the five that has already come forward. So this is not necessarily a sixth. It is just confirmation to a bigger news outlet, like a what are they? WBZ TV, their Channel 4 in Boston. Okay, so that's where she's a reporter, and so she is reporting. You know, she they came. Or, well, I don't know who came who, but she is reporting specifically that she can confirm she spoke with a juror face to face. She does say somewhere along the lines in the comments, somebody's like, "How do you know it's a real juror?" And she's like, "I spoke to them face to face. I know it was them because I've seen them in the jury before." She goes on to say that the juror confirmed that the jury was hung on a lesser included charges under charge 2, which was manslaughter. Their final vote was a soft 9-3 with 9 voting guilty, which is very concerning to me. I don't know how 9 people could even get to 9 guilty manslaughter, but that would mean you'd still have to think that she hit him with a car, or they were caught up on some other language that had nothing to do with a car accident. That's the only other thing. Or they're a plant, a McAlbert or a Commonwealth plant. Because it benefits the McAlberts and the Commonwealth. Those are the only people it benefits to have a mistrial. So it has to be. All right. So the jury considered being more specific in their notes to the judge, but were not clear on how they were supposed to communicate their unanimous decisions on charges 1 and 3. So that is specifically. This is the very first juror that has come forward to a news outlet. So that is why this is big news. This is breaking news. It's not just the defense making some stuff up in their motions. It is the jurors are seeking news media now to tell their story because what's happening isn't fair. So with that in mind, let's move to the hearing. Which, like I said, I have no idea what's going to happen. So I'm watching it. This is my genuine reaction with you guys. Let me unmute and get us going.
You are unmuted.
Oh, perfect. Let me turn my mic down just a little.
All right, the court, please. Now, open your main seat.
Judge 22117,
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
Good morning. Good afternoon,
Your Honor.
Martin Weinberg, appearing on behalf of Karen.
Good.
So this is the new attorney that is representing Karen. Mark, did you say Mark Weinberg? That's right, right? Oh, that's Jackson. I can't remember. Marty, right? Martin Weinberg. Hold on. I got to get this right. Sorry about that. It is Martin Weinberg looking at the motion to dismiss. He is on here. And he's from Boston. They're also working with this other gentleman, Michael Pabian Esquire. And he wrote the brief, I believe. This brief, the motion to dismiss. So that's who they're working with now. So that's who just came on the screen and introduced himself. Alan Jackson is and Liza Little are back in LA, so they will not be at this hearing.
Good afternoon, Mr. Weinberg. It's nice to see you.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. David Gennetti for Karen Reed.
Good afternoon, Mr. Gennetti. Good afternoon, Ms. Reed.
All right, so the case is scheduled today for trial assignment, and what I'd like to do is to get three dates. I'm aware that a motion to dismiss has been filed. I'd like to get a quick date on that, and I'm glad you're here, Mr. Weinberg, because I'd like it to be with your schedule. Then we need a trial date, and we need a final trial conference. So I was thinking of the motion to
a trial date and a final trial conference, so like a pre-trial conference, I'm assuming, like when they finalize things and do their motions in limine right before jury deliberations, or not jury, jury voir dire selection, and before trial starts.
Dismiss, can we do it a week from Friday?
Wait, what?
It would be on the motion to dismiss, then we need a trial date, and we need a final trial conference. So I was thinking on the motion to dismiss, can we do it a week from Friday?
The motion to dismiss she wants to do a week from Friday. So that would be August 2nd. Let's see what they say.
It would be for oral argument only.
From the defendant's perspective, yes, Your Honor.
All right, I think that's August 2nd,
Mr. Chair. I'm going to be honest.
They're here. Like, why can't they argue it right now? They're here. They've both put in their things. Like, why can't they be prepared to argue that? I don't know. I mean, I guess this was just a scheduling conference, so you can't, like, but you could tell them ahead of time, like, okay, we can argue this here. Just, you know, I don't know. Does that not work that way in the court of law? You just waste everybody's time to come in for 5 minutes to schedule something and then leave? Because that's probably all this is going to be. She's going to ignore the whole your whatevers.
I return on August 3rd.
Okay. August 9th?
Oh my God, that's
2 o'clock. Are you available, Mr. Weinberg, on August 9th? Mr. Lally, is the Commonwealth available on August 9th?
Yes, Your Honor.
All right, so that's for oral argument.
Okay, so that's like 3 weeks from now. We'll be hearing almost 3 weeks from now, or a little less. We'll be hearing argument from both sides regarding the motions to dismiss for counts 1 and 3. So we're probably not going to hear anything on the jurors today.
2 p.m. All right, so given the schedule, and I assume whatever I end up doing on the motion to dismiss will be appealed, in an effort to...
So you're right now, you're just letting us know that you're going to deny it, because a denial would be appealed, right? I mean, I don't think the Commonwealth would appeal a judge's decision in squashing the charges. So did she just show us her hand that she's going to be dismissing or denying their motion? Let's hear that again.
Okay.
2 p.m.
All right. So given the schedule, and I assume whatever I end up doing on the motion to dismiss will be appealed, in an effort to make sure we have plenty of time, I would like to schedule the jury trial on January 27th.
January of next year. Holy crap.
Is the Commonwealth available?
That's fine, Your Honor.
Mr. Nettie?
That should be fine.
Okay, so January 27th for trial. And let's do the final trial conference the week of the 13th or even the week of the 6th. Do you have the calendar, Mr. Clerk, or any of those days?
Yeah, there's nothing, just not the 9th or the 16th, but all the days are open.
Okay.
Your Honor, the only caveat is I don't have anything on the 27th. I'm clear for that date, but for the fact that I have a Superior Court trial scheduled to begin in Essex County on January 13th. There are multiple...
How long do you expect it to
take? That's what I was getting to. That could take longer than 2 weeks. I'm happy to have this case take priority over that, but that's...
No, we'll hold it for you day to day if need be, and I can contact the Essex Superior Court judge once you know who he or she is.
Yeah, that's not ideal. You know, in terms of preparing for trial, I can't do 2 or 3 weeks Superior Court trial and then jump into this case. I can't do that.
Okay.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So what are you telling me? You just said you're willing to make this a priority, so we'll stick with the 27th?
Well, okay. Well, why don't we do this? Let's put it on for the 27th. Let me see if I can make peace in Essex County. And then on the next date when we come back for oral argument, I can readdress the court on that issue.
Okay. I'm happy to talk to Judge McCarthy, who's the Raj up there, about this.
It's my... Yeah, okay. That's great.
All right. So let's set it for the 27th.
What is talking to the other judge going to do? It's not going to make their case go by any quicker. I mean, if a case takes 3 weeks to present, that's how long it takes. There shouldn't be a time limit. Like, she didn't give them a time limit only on their closing arguments, but there shouldn't be a time limit on your presentation, your case that you're going to present to the jury. If you say it's going to take 3 weeks and it accidentally takes you four, oh well, oops, sorry, my bad, I miscalculated, but I needed this other whatever, you know, things happen and sometimes things get delayed. So I don't know. It's just, okay. So he's got a superior court trial, and if it's done in 2 weeks, let's say on the quicker end, it's done in 2 weeks. He has to rush right into a new trial, which this is like huge, this trial. He can't just go from a Supreme Court trial to this. He needs a little time to prep, I think, and some breathing room in between. So hopefully they are able to work something out. I have no idea. All right, let's continue on.
And why don't we do the 14th for final trial conference?
The 14th at 9 or 2?
2. If it turns out that we have, you know, in excess of 35 or whatever motions in limine still at that point, let us know and we will try and get the whole day. Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All eyes to the court, please.
Not a word on the jurors. I knew this would happen. I knew she wasn't, she probably wouldn't even address it, and she didn't. So we have to come back for August 9th for oral arguments regarding the motion to dismiss, and then possibly a jury trial January 27th with a pretrial hearing on the 14th of January. So that's where we landed here. So that's it. I mean, nothing more. I'll just mute it and play it out the rest of the way while we... I don't think they're talking anymore. Yeah, so that was very anticlimactic, very unsatisfactory because nothing happened. We're all sitting here waiting for things to be done about the fact that the juror is... this is a different courtroom, by the way. Just in case you were wondering why it looked different, but... so we're all sitting here waiting for some kind of an answer or response from Judge Cannone regarding the five jurors that have come forward so far, now to the media. If she keeps ignoring it, I surely and truly hope that more and more individuals who are on that jury will come forward and speak to the media, even if it's anonymous. Do it anonymously, please. We need you. We need you to speak up. We have to. This movement, the Karen Reed movement, we need everybody. We need everyone's help to stop corruption. So even if just sharing a video about it or liking my video so that it gets out to more people, those are all good things that you can do just to help spread the word and get it out there. All right, so that was very boring and anticlimactic. Let's talk now about intimidation by the Canton Townies. So actually, let's start with that. Hold on 1 second. Copy link. This video is the latest Canton Select Board meeting. So if you'll recall, I did a video on two Select Board meetings back. So this is Canton Select Board. These are like the people that run the town, the board that, you know, oversees everything, like renewing the chief of police's contract, even though she's corrupt and not doing anything about her corrupt officers. And this all happened under her watch. But anyways, that's a whole nother story. So they oversee things like that. Well, the town people have been coming out in droves to try to speak. They give them about 15 minutes to talk and they cut everybody off. They don't answer anybody's questions. They don't respond to anybody's comments. They basically just want to shut the people up. And in the two town meetings ago, there were hecklers in the seats that were McAlberts or friends of the McAlberts. And they were heckling all the people that had anything negative to say about the corruption or the police, the issues with the police. And let me turn my mic back up. So any of those people that criticize the police, they would be heckling and getting rowdy in the crowd. But yet the calm, peaceful people that were doing, you know, playing by the rules, they get thrown out. So it's just insulting and amazing how deep the corruption goes. So this is because of that whole meeting and everything, just, you know, people getting kicked out and whatnot, the hecklers, they moved their next meeting to a Zoom meeting. So this is their Zoom meeting, okay? And I'm going to play for you just a portion of Rita Lombardi. She's on my thumbnail. If you look, she's in the red shirt there. She's so cute. Rita Lombardi is, she calls in to the Canton board or select board and talks about the difference between the us and them, the elect or the elite towny people versus everybody else. So this is her talking about that to the Canton board. And of course they just ignore her, but I think she did a great job. So here we go. And this is the chairperson of the board. Oh.
I'd just like to say, since the murder of John O'Keefe, this town has been deeply divided. Instead of seeing improvement, we continue the downward spiral of destruction. At last week's select board meeting, the division was amplified when a group of entitled townies who refer to themselves as Canton First decided to rally others to attend the meeting for the sole purpose of heckling and bullying peaceful and passionate citizens seeking truth and accountability from our leaders. Much to their satisfaction, they were successful in their efforts to wreak havoc and did so without consequences, a familiar theme in Canton. They successfully kept the focus on General Donnell while continuing to heckle her without any de-escalation efforts from the retired police detective hired to stand guard in the meeting. While she was asking him if he was going to do his job and uphold the same meeting room standards to the hecklers, he ignored the bullies, assaulted her, and made her leave the meeting. I did hear that after the meeting, he spoke gently to some of the bullies. It was a double standard. It is important to note that last week, the same group of entitled townies, Canton First, also circulated a toxic letter collecting endorsement signatures declaring their independence from my publicly expressed views and opinions. While they failed the publication in the Canton Citizen, their letter and ad hoc signatures ended up all over Twitter and social media for the world to see. While the letter was toxic, by signing it, the individuals inadvertently provided valuable information for the world to see. Nearly all of the valid voter names are employees or family and friends of employees of the town of Canton.
What? They just gave themselves away. They just outed themselves, all the people that are anti-free Karen Reed people, the people that hate the free Karen Reed folks that are out there, the supporters. These are the anti-supporters, and they don't like the supporters, and they're out there doing serious damage. Like, I just read last night, somebody's lug nuts on their tire were loosened. Their tire almost fell off while they were running errands coming home. Because they had a free Karen Reed sign on their car. And they're like, I'm positive that's the only reason why somebody could have done that. Somebody, that's attempted homicide. Whoever did that. I mean, this is getting nuts. The way that these individuals are getting violent and threatening. So, like Rita pointed out, it's an us and them. There's the elite and the not so elite. What was I going to show you next? So, speaking of threatening, so this is coming from a... Why can't I zoom that in anymore? Oh, here. So this is coming from... It's a Cowboys fan. I think it's 105. Yeah, Cowboy fan 105. And this is believed to be... oh, let me switch over. This is believed to be Chris Albert and his tweet or Twitter account, whatever. All right, so it says, "Dear Karen Reed jurors, no more of this anonymous shit. Put your effing names to it. Show your face." Okay. This was recent. This was in the last few days, like after all the affidavits started coming out. The first couple affidavits started coming out. This is when this came out, this post. And then this person replies, "Why? So you can send Brian Albert to teach them a lesson?" And Cowboy Fan responds, "Hell yes. They will see our faces 24/7. These people are not bright. You don't put that on the internet. All right, so "Dear Karen Reed jurors," oh, this is the same one, no more anonymous, whatever. This person replies, or this person says, "Nervous, Chris?" And then this person, I thought this was a great response, says, "This is why Bev kept their names under seal. You've already had to apologize once this week, albeit a rather weak and insincere apology." Then it goes on, it cuts it off, but I think it says, go on, I think it goes on to say something like, you know, let's not make that a weekly thing, because he had to make an apology at the select board the last time, and it was a really half-assed apology. It was really terrible. And this is finally the last one that I'm going to show you from Cowboy Fan 105. He says, "Dear Karen Reed jurors, your jury service is complete. You have lost all right to remain anonymous with these additional filings by the defense." So these, remember, these came out right after the defense filed all those anonymous affidavits, the first three that came out. Sorry, let me just move my mic. I feel like it's far away. All right, "We have a right to your identities as you try to circumvent the laws of our Commonwealth." So they're trying to, this person really wants to know the identities of the jurors. I think they've already been reached by, or at least one has been reached by a McAlbert. But this is definitely a McAlbert. Anyways, what do you guys think of that? Interesting, huh? All right, so another thing that happened, and this is more internet terrorism, I guess. So there's this company called Double Good Popcorn. They sell popcorn and help do fundraisers. And it says, you know, it's a fundraising mechanism, or I would think anybody could use it. However, on their website, it says something about, you know, founded for like helping the youth help like achieve their dreams for baseball teams to go to Disneyland or whatever they want. So this is what happened. Apparently, a bunch of people complained to Double Good because that's the source that Karen Reed had been using for the last three, or rather Karen Reed supporters, had been using for the last three gigantic fundraisers. They raised a lot of money for Karen Reed and for the Double Good popcorn place, because every, you know, half $50 or 50% goes to, sorry, 50% proceeds go to, it's a 50-50 split is what I'm trying to say. So they both made a lot of money in these, but what, for whatever reason, these a-hole antiers that keep trying to just make a mess out of everything, they reached out to this Double Good company trying to make it seem like you're helping a murderer get defense funds, and how could you defend a murderer and all this stuff. So, well, whatever. This was their response. "Hi, and thank you for reaching out. We understand your concerns and hear you. First of all, remember that Karen Reed is not convicted of anything at this point. She is an innocent woman fighting for her life." I just want to say that. While Double Good was designed to raise joy and create opportunity for America's youth. Our platform ease of use does occasionally attract organizers that are outside that company vision. But there's nothing on your company website that says you must be under 18 to use this website for fundraising. Nothing like that. There's nothing in their website that says this is strictly for these types of things. I don't know what their terms of service or policy is, but they even say right here. What does that say? Okay, so subsequently, as the Karen Reed fundraiser did not violate our terms of service. They say it did not violate our terms of service. It was allowed to remain active for its duration within our system. That said, we are permanently freezing this fundraising organizer moving forward. Why? Because a bunch of individuals who have an axe to grind wanted to complain, because some people complained you're going to say they can no longer use your platform. If you know anything about this company, or if you can reach out to this company just to complain about them freezing her popcorn fundraising rights, I would, because apparently they caved to pressure very easily. So that said, we are permanently freezing their fundraising, this fundraising organizer moving forward, which will prevent any future funds from being raised through our platform. Thank you for your patience as we navigate this ongoing situation. So that was a response to the anti-Karen Reed people, because they didn't like that they were raising money for her, for a woman fighting for her life, because the Commonwealth has all the money and all the power, and she's needed to sell her house and raise money multiple times to pay for her experts and her attorneys. And they have a problem with us. And I don't understand why. It's not coming from their pocket, so who gives a F? This is terrorism at its finest. And if you don't believe me, let's look at the next segment. So let me grab the link, sorry. This next clip I'm going to show you is a news clip from what's going on in Canton. What's happening in Canton?
Now to an NBC 10 Boston exclusive as police investigate how bleach ended up damaging front yards and other property in Canton.
Coincidentally, all of these Canton homeowners supported Karen Reed during her trial. So NBC 10's Mary Marcos live in the newsroom for us. Mary, this is or is not a coincidence?
Who's to say? But the police are looking into it, and one woman is now adding cameras around her house in Canton because of these pranks, and they aren't confident in the police as far as whether they're going to do anything about it.
I don't know. I guess it's an easy way to not get your fingerprints on anything.
This case has ripped this town apart.
Rita Lombardi and Brenda Sweeney have not been shy about voicing their concerns with corruption in town ever since Karen Reed's murder case began. Over the course of the past week, the neighbors started finding random patches of dead grass in their yard and decaying vegetables in their garden. They didn't think much of it until they found pieces of colorful plastic and unpopped balloons filled with bleach on their own lawn. They even found a bag full of them on their street, so they called the Canton police, the chief releasing a statement saying in part, quote, any type of act in this community or any community for that matter that places another in fear for their safety and or diminishes their quality of life is unacceptable. The Canton police chief says the evidence will be transferred to the Plymouth County Bureau of Criminal Investigation for further review, but these women doubt much will come from the investigation.
I don't think anything's going to come of the investigation either, because they don't care. The Canton police don't care unless you're one of the elite townies. They don't care. And the elite townies can get away with property damage and terrorizing individuals within the town, apparently attempted homicide by loosening lug nuts on some woman's car. I was reading it on, I wish I had saved it. I was reading that on, Twitter, X, whatever it is.
Oh, I think it's horrific. And they're trying to scare us into just shutting up and sitting down and letting things get back to as usual in town, which we don't want to happen.
Their bullying behavior is nothing new. They have been bullies their entire life, and they have never been held to consequences. That's what you're seeing right now. They know they can do this and get away with it. There will be nobody held accountable for this. I guarantee you.
Now, Karen Reed and her attorneys are due back in court on Monday. That's when they could select a date for the retrial. Live in the news.
Yeah, which we just watched, and they did. And it's only a tentative date anyways, because David Unetti's in trial before that, so he might have to move around his court trial that he has. All right, so we went over this, the Chris Albert's social media, the Double Good Popcorn. We went all over all of that. So finally, let's talk about how many tabs open here now that I'm done with those. All right, so this recently, 3 days ago, Aiden Carney, Turtle Boy, posted this on his website. The Canton cover-up part 375 Trooper Buchanan goes to Woburn and Walpole. I know I'm probably not saying those right. To harass and intimidate women who messaged Jen McCabe and Elizabeth Proctor last year. So these women apparently either messaged or called or whatever one of the elite, Canton elite, and now Proctor, not Proctor, because Proctor's gone. So it's Sergeant Buchanan, or as he goes by another name, and this other new guy, was his name Kelly or O'Kelly? I can't remember. Anyways, so we're going to watch a couple clips of them basically harassing these women. There's two women that they went to go talk to. I don't want to read the whole thing, but maybe I should. Okay, we'll start here. So Buchanan arrived with his partner. Let me make that a little bit bigger. And we'll play the videos along because with the article. All right. So when Buchanan arrived with his partner, Detective Kelly, he told the woman's autistic son that his mother might have witnessed something. So that's two goons driving up. Was there a sentence before that? Okay, so two women in Walpole and Woburn have been harassed and intimidated in the last 24 hours by disgraced Sergeant Yuri, that word, Buchanan. I'm not going to say that on my channel because I'll get striked, but I don't mind the word. I think it's funny. All right, so anyways, so that, he's a disgraced detective. Because they came knocking on these doors and harassing these women because they either called or messaged Jen McCabe and Elizabeth Proctor. Last year, Lizzie made headlines when she harassed the employers of several people who made comments on social media suggesting that her husband, Michael Proctor, was complicit in covering up the loss of John O'Keefe's life. Lizzie admitted under oath in court that she did this to the victims because she was upset with the things that they were saying online about her husband. After I published a story, Turtle Boy, that included links to her employer's social media, I was charged with felony witness intimidation because she is the family member of a witness. That's such BS. In the Karen Reed case, because Michael Proctor is a witness. He's the lead investigator. How does that make him a witness? He should be a witness automatically, but that doesn't make him a protected witness of, like, I don't know, like from mafia and gangs and stuff like that. That's usually who you're seeing intimidate witnesses, especially for law enforcement, but whatever. All right. So when Lizzie tries to inflict economic harm on strangers for exercising their First Amendment rights on Facebook, it's okay. But when people attempt to let her employer know about her behavior, it's called felony witness intimidation. You see, she's a special class of citizen and you're not. And this is what this whole argument has been. what Rita was saying in the Canton Select Board meeting, and it's different rules for different folks. If you are connected to the town of Canton, the people that run the town of Canton, if you are connected to the law enforcement in Canton, you're fine. But anybody else, there's different rules for different folks in Canton. So a 52-year-old woman in Walpole reported to us that she had her house visited after calling Elizabeth Proctor's employer in Strum twice on July 12th. So she called Elizabeth Proctor's workplace two times in July. So what? All right. So although we did not direct anyone to do this and would highly recommend people just read the articles we publish without acting on them, same, it is well within this woman and anybody's First Amendment rights to call whoever they want and to think whatever they want to think. But Yuri Bukenik doesn't want this individual to think that Karen Reed is innocent. That's not allowed, apparently, in Canton. All right, so Lizzie's husband is a public figure who has been suspended without pay and will likely be fired for misconduct related to the Reed case. And I thought we were going to find out this week or this last week if Michael Proctor was fired or not, but they did not announce anything. They had a meeting, but it didn't talk about wrong thing. I'm sorry, guys. Here. This website has so many pop-up ads. There we go. That's better for you guys. I don't remember what I was saying. All right. So Lizzie was trying to get people fired. And now these other individuals are coming forward and calling her or texting John McCabe, and they're getting harassed by Yuri Bukenik and his new partner. What's his butt? And Michael Proctor, by the way, is, as we were saying, suspended without pay, and he's probably going to be fired. So what happened to that? Because we were supposed to find out when... or I thought we were supposed to find out last week what was going to happen to Michael Proctor. Where did I leave off? I cannot find it. Hold on. I can't find the spot I left off. Okay, here we go. Lizzie's husband is a public figure who has been suspended without pay and will likely be fired related to the Karen Reed case. Lizzie has not been a passive wife either. She proudly and loudly supports her husband's behavior and has tried to silence anyone who disagrees. Earlier in the month, she falsely accused NBC reporter Kathy Curran of trespassing on her lawn when she showed up to her house to ask questions. And we played it before, but I can play it again if you want.
We have our team in place tonight at 6, but let's begin with NBC 10 investigator Kathy Curran. Kathy, you just spoke exclusively with one of the central figures in this case, State Police Trooper Michael Proctor. We all know his name, and it sounds like he wasn't thrilled to see you.
Well, Glenn, you know, there's a lot of pressure on the lead investigator, Trooper Michael Proctor. We heard the disturbing texts about Karen Reed that he sent to friends, family members, and coworkers. There's an internal investigation by state police, and we know there's an ongoing federal investigation into how this case was handled. Proctor was at his home in Canton this afternoon when the Karen Reed case ended in a mistrial. We caught up with him just a few moments ago to ask him his thoughts on the outcome of the case.
Trooper Proctor, Kathy Curran from NBC 10. We'd like to ask you some questions. Do you think your actions impacted the outcome of the trial?
Get off of our lawn.
I'm not on your lawn. I'm on the street. Do you have anything you'd like to say?
I fully support my husband. Karen Reed is a murderer.
You support your husband?
And you heard it there. His wife fully supports him and called Karen Reed a murderer. Testimony in the case showed Proctor was.
Yep. So there you go. We watched that before. Very interesting. And she lied about the woman being on her lawn. She's like, get off my lawn. When they called John the Nevercracker for him wanting everyone off of his lawn, when, as you could see, they all messed with him about that. From trial, we saw that. All right, so when Sergeant Pukenik arrived at his partner, Detective Kelly, he told this woman's autistic son that his mother might have witnessed something. For what it's worth, the Walpole woman never spoke to anyone at Instrom. She told us that she only called to find out if she still worked there because there were unconfirmed reports online that she had been fired. The second time she left a message asking why Elizabeth thought it was okay to call people's places of work and how she felt about Mike's situation now, and said that what has happened to him is a repercussion of his own disgusting work ethics, which I love. Then she ended it with quack quack, because that goes back to the whole duck thing with the rubber duckies. There was a rubber ducky that was left on the sidewalk in front of D&E Pizza owned by Chris Albert, and then they sent like four police cars that day when they found it, and they're like, who's the, you know, looking for, they actually had two search warrants for this one guy to find rubber duckies and whatever fake money that they were using that had like Colin was in the house written all over it. And they actually are wasting police resources to track down people who left a duck on D&E, on the sidewalk in front of D&E, not even in D&E, I don't think. So, like, public property, sidewalk. Anyways, so Elizabeth Proctor called her back three times. The woman didn't answer. Wow. Elizabeth Proctor called her back. Sergeant Buchanan came back later when the woman was home, according to her, Sergeant Buchanan and Detective Kelly were laying in wait for her. So this is the woman's quote. They swarmed in, Buchanan blocked me in, and Kelly's car came in front the other way. So both cars were facing each other. I asked if all of this was necessary, and I said, apparently you have my phone number. Why didn't you just call me to come in and talk to you guys where I could be recorded in an interrogation room? He said it was out of respect for the person and not to try to take away from their day. What? I then said, since we're on the subject, I find it kind of odd that the witnesses that were in the house that night were never brought in and officially questioned in an official interrogation room. And he said, that's not necessarily done or required. I said, are you serious? A goddamn Boston police officer was found on the lawn of another Boston police officer, and you guys never went into the house except to interview people. I said, you don't think with the loss of a Boston police officer's life on another Boston police officer's lawn, that would require people to be brought into the office. He said, not necessarily, and I said, that's a crock of shit. Oh my God. Like, how can you even respect these people anymore? If Sergeant Buchanan came to my door, I would not respect him either. I would mouth off back to them also. According to the woman, Sergeant Buchanan trying to corner me and make me admit things. He repeatedly asked her what her intent was and said, hold on. Okay, just loud noises from the dog, sorry. All right, so according to the woman, Buchanan was trying to corner me and make me admit things. He admittedly asked her what her intent was and said that calling Lizzie Proctor's employer is witness intimidation. No, it's not. And that she could be arrested for it. He told her that the McAlberts had been harassed for over a year. Yeah, right. The woman brought up what happened to Meredith and Turtle Boy. That was when Chris, Albert, and a bunch of goons, Juliana Nagel, Brian Nagel, Sam Nagel, like all these people got up in Turtle Boy's face and they were really obnoxious. That's when Jim Ferris and Jill Daniels assaulted him right there in the sidewalk in front of everybody to see. And of course, they still have not nothing's happened to them. They have not been charged, but they have a meeting with a magistrate. It's all on video, so I don't know how they can even deny it, but whatever. Or deny the charges for Turtle Boy. So the woman brought up that what happened to Meredith and Turtle Boy as an example of intimidation without mentioning our names at CF McCarthy's a few weeks back when we were harassed and assaulted by several McAlberts in broad daylight. Bukenik repeatedly tried to get her to say our names and admit that she was acting on my behalf. Quote, he asked if I was going to do something to harm the witnesses and victims. He was trying everything to get me to say it was Aiden that I got it, my info from. The woman was livid. He got me so mad. The way that they came in, they acted like I took someone's life. He was referring to all those involving in taking John's life as the victims, and the more that he did that, the more pissed off I got. I kept on thinking about Karen and Aiden. He wouldn't answer me when I asked him if it was necessary, meaning the drama of coming in the way they did. He kept on referring to them and what they've been through the past year like they're the freaking victims. And somehow it got me to talk about what I did. I will admit I was scared because I know what they're capable of. He said what I did was witness intimidation. I said, well, why don't you focus on the fact that Jen erased the calls and Google searches? I knew if I didn't shut up, I was going to end up in jail because he didn't like what I was saying. When I saw him get out of the car, I started laughing and I said, oh, wow, I know who you are. You are Sergeant. She said it. I'm not going to repeat it, but she said it. The woman took three videos of the, it's a intimate, it's not really a position, I wouldn't say, like an intimate position, the name of an intimate position, but it's kind of like an intimate act, you know, an S-E act, if you don't know, that's what it is about, so it's kind of a funny nickname, but YouTube doesn't like the word, so I don't want to use it. All right, so the woman took three videos of the encounter. He told her to think about the information being shared with you. Those are his quotes, his words. He persisted that she was getting her information about the O'Keefe case from Turtle Boy and asked her, am I right or wrong about you learning that on the internet? The woman wisely asked him why he wanted to know where she got her information from, but he persisted. He told her it was her right to believe whatever she wanted. Well, thank you very much, Sergeant Bukenik, for letting her think whatever she wants. Jerk. All right, so this is the first video of three for this particular individual, this woman.
And think about the information that's being, you know, shared with you.
See, I'm.
So, am I right or am I wrong about you learning that on the internet?
It was the actual people that lost their jobs.
Somebody lost their job, actually.
Absolutely.
And they said that.
From Lizzie Proctor calling and complaining about these people. This is what they do. They are mean girl bullies. This whole town. The wives of these officers are mean girls. And they have the time to just go around and harass people online and call people's places of business and harass them. Apparently this is their fun time.
To you in person or was it on the internet?
Why do you want me to say it was on the internet?
Because I'm asking where you learned this information from.
I think you know.
I don't know. That's what I'm talking. Again, if I knew stuff, I would just write a report because I already know it. And I wouldn't waste my time talking to you. So I'm asking, did you learn this stuff on the internet, on social media, on some sort of platform, or was it in person from a loved one, relative, friend, acquaintance?
No, it was none of my family.
Okay.
And I believe it.
All right, that's fine. Listen, it's your right to believe
what
you...
I have so much to say, but I'm not...
Go ahead.
No.
That was video one. And this is a continuing on with Turtle Boy's blog. He says, this is what your tax dollars paid for today. This is what the Massachusetts State Police are investigating instead of crime. If it's her right to believe whatever she wants, then why are they going around policing speech? Why should she think about the information being shared with her? Why is it any of the state police's business? She can consume information any way she wants to consume information. Clearly, they were trying to get her to say that she got information from Turtle Boy in an effort to prove that I am somehow facilitating witness intimidation. That's exactly what they were doing. In the second video, he asks her, what is the reason you called these people and tried to take justice into your own hands? He told her that he could arrest her if there was an arrestable offense, and he said that he followed criminal procedure to a T.
Again, what was the reason why you called these people and decided to take justice into your own
hands? See, I don't know what to answer, not to answer, because I don't know. You could arrest me right now.
Mr. Pola, I don't know the law.
Okay.
Right.
No, fine. I'm interviewing you about your actions. I could arrest you if there's a crime and an arrestable offense. We play by the rules, and there's strict rules, policies, criminal procedure that we follow to the T. Okay? Just because you don't believe.
Does that criminal policy and procedure include snow blowers and red solo cups for evidence collection? And Stop and Shop bags and planting taillight pieces and lying on reports about your relations with these people, lying to your supervisors about relations with these individuals that you are investigating, supposedly, but they never investigated. So, yeah.
Believe it doesn't mean that that's not fact. Right, so you saying that you're afraid that I can arrest you because of...
Oh, he's such a tool. All right, so calling someone on the phone isn't taking justice into your own hands. She called Elizabeth Proctor because it's a free country and she can call whoever she wants. And it's laughable that the guy who works for an organization that didn't search the home of a property where a cop was found not alive repeatedly lied in police reports for a homicide investigation and never interviewed witnesses or recorded any interviews with people inside 34 Fairview Road. Followed criminal procedure to a T. Yeah, right. Why is this not... I don't know. Here, that's better. Why is it not fitting the screen now? All right, so the Walpole woman asked him about the Ford Edge Lucky Law friend saw in front of Brian Albert's house, and Buchanek told her that she can't believe everything she learns on the internet. So he tells her, you got to think about what you're learning on the internet, and then you can't believe everything that you hear on the internet. When she asked about the ARCA experts who testified that John O'Keefe wasn't hit by a car, he said he couldn't comment on an active investigation. She told him that she hopes the state police investigate the Alberts when they harass and intimidate people, and he told her that she should have reported it. The Ford Edge, Lucky Loughran, the individual who testified about the Ford Edge, he told that to Sergeant Buchanek. In the only transcripted police interview that took place in the case of John O'Keefe investigating his loss of life, it's the only recorded interview, and it was Proctor and Buchanek and Lucky. And Lucky's the one that told them about the Ford Edge. And he kept trying to say, well, did Turtle Boy do this? Or, you know, he kept trying to somehow bring the conversation back to Turtle Boy. They just want to indict Turtle Boy on made up charges that totally violate his First Amendment rights. And they don't care about the investigation of John O'Keefe, which is very evident. All right, this is the final video for this one.
Did anyone find out about that Ford Edge in front of the house?
Again, you can't believe everything you learn, you hear on the internet. Okay.
What about?
You can't believe everything you
lucky
hear
the snowfall guy who it's true. And what about the scientific facts and experts that said John wasn't hit by a car? So, anyways, I know you can't get into it.
Yep. He didn't have anything to say. He's just looking at her like, okay, buddy. She got you there, and you have nothing to say. And look at the way he stands. He just stands like a total douchebag.
I really hope that you investigate these people, the McAlberts, when they do their harassing. And
well, you got to report it, but you're claiming you don't trust the police.
Because it's not...
But you're not reporting it. You got to report it.
I don't, and it's sad.
I wouldn't trust police either in Canton or whatever town this is, but in Norfolk County, I wouldn't trust a lot of the police over there. I'd be scared in Massachusetts for sure with all the state police everywhere that could be corrupt. All right. So that was, oh wait, there was more of that article. Sorry. Because they go to another individual's home. So newsflash, it has been reported the incidents of the people that have incidents where a McCabe or an Albert, a McCabe, somebody in their crew is violent or whatever. Those things do get reported. So, but they don't. But nothing ever happens to the people because they're connected to the ones who would be doing the punishing. The Canton police responded and told me that they were charging Jill Daniels and Jim Ferris with assault and battery. To this day, no one has been charged. Nothing ever happens to the McAlberts when they intimidate or threaten people because the cops work for them. That's the whole problem here. There are two classes of citizens in Norfolk County, and the fact that he told her not to believe things on the internet when it was his interview with Lucky Loughran that was published and contained the part about the Ford Edge shows how blatantly corrupt he is. Another woman in Woburn said that Buchanan and Kelly visited her same day or that afternoon this was. She didn't answer the door, but you can see them ringing the doorbell. Got a nice garden there. Nothing really happens. It's just them standing around. They don't even talk, but just look at the way they stand. Well, Buchanan especially. He's always got like one leg cocked forward. It just makes him look douchey. What's with the bald? Like, he's got his head shaved except a little bit of hair right there. That's weird. Right? I wouldn't answer the door either. If an officer... Let's mute those. If an officer ever were to come to your home to talk to you about something, definitely pull out your camera if you are going to talk to them. I definitely highly recommend that you don't. I highly recommend you ignore them. Tell them to go away. Tell them, you know, I'm not talking to you without a lawyer. It doesn't even matter if you think that you're being a suspect it doesn't even matter if you think you're a suspect or not. I would just recommend getting it either on camera would be probably the least satisfactory, getting it on camera. But definitely, I would recommend like not even talking to them, just saying, you know, I don't feel comfortable talking to you without an attorney. Goodbye, sir. And if they try to like intimidate you and strong arm you, just be firm and say, I'm sorry, I'm not going to speak to you without an attorney present. And say, unless you have a warrant, goodbye. Good day, sir. See you later. That's what I would do. Just a little advice. Don't talk to the police unless you have an attorney present or you absolutely have to. I mean, if you're reporting something and you're the one calling, I guess, you know, you can talk to the police. But in most other circumstances, I would recommend not doing it. So lastly, I just wanted to go over very quickly Aiden's indictments, because a lot of people might not understand or be aware of what's really going on with Aiden Turtle Boy. And so I've got a PowerPoint that I made from episode 12, Turtle Boy's Indictments, and I'm just going to kind of go over the timeline, the dates, just for those newer folks who aren't aware necessarily of Turtle Boy's history. So I'm going to try to just hit the highlights and make it fast, because it's a long, drawn-out drama. But anyways, so Aiden has been covering this case for over a year now. I've been following him for at least a year now, more than a year, like April of last year. And he's basically been like the key front runner to create the Karen Reed, the Free Karen Reed movement. He's created protests and standouts, and he's been a leader to a lot of people out there. But he also breaks stories that the Commonwealth doesn't want him breaking, because it has to do with exposing their corruption and their cover-ups and the way that they're unethical and their misconduct. So that's the problem with Turtle Boy, is that he's speaking the truth, they don't like it, and they're trying to shut him up. So this whole thing has always been about silencing him. And even Juror Doe, that affidavit was written in support of silencing Turtle Boy, in my opinion. All right, so some important dates just to kind of quickly go over. So he was first arrested and arraigned in October of 2023. He had 9 witness intimidation charges. He was released on his own recognizance. Shortly thereafter, he had a grand jury indictment that came. And this is when they upped his charges. They became federal charges at this point. So now he's facing even more time and stricter penalties and federal prison, lifetime in federal prison for witness intimidation, 16 total counts now. It's been brought up, which went from 9 to 16. They're really weaponizing this particular statute, which is totally unconstitutional anyways, which says that you can't commit emotional harm on someone. You right now could have hurt feelings about something I said in my stream. That's not harassment. You know what I'm saying? Like they have totally weaponized a statute that is meant for witnesses in the cases like, you know, you're trying to coerce someone's testimony to be a certain way. All Aiden has ever done is tell these people to tell the truth about what happened in that house. And because he's been doing that, they say he's harassing them. But they are not denying that they're the ones that took John's life. They just say he wasn't in the house. But we know they're not truthful. We saw them all on the stand. All right, so grand jury, 16 counts now in December. He's then arraigned in Superior Court December 22nd. The stay-away conditions are lifted. So in Superior Court, they don't have the jurisdiction, basically, to do certain things, which one was the stay-away conditions, the restraining order, whatever, to stay away from the quote-unquote witnesses. So let's actually talk about the charges. Let me find it. Okay. So for the first charge, these are all indictments on October 11th. The first charge was witness intimidation of a witness, Elizabeth and Michael Proctor. That was combined in one for some reason. These are his charges as they were laid out. Charge number two, intimidation of a witness, picketing a witness, Juliana Nagel. Number three, intimidation of a witness, Julie Albert. Number four, intimidation of a witness, Chris Albert. Number five, picketing a witness, Michael Proctor. Six, intimidation of a witness, Colin Albert. Seven, conspiracy to commit intimidation of a witness, Jen McCabe and Elizabeth Proctor. Eight, intimidation of a witness, picketing a witness, Matt McCabe and Jen McCabe. And nine, intimidation of a witness, picketing a witness, Matt McCabe and Jen McCabe. And after that, I didn't update this spreadsheet. It was just, I don't think we ever saw the extended charges. I never did. They had his original witness intimidation charges that was made public, but then after that, I never saw the how they expanded his charges. And they've still, to this day, have not given discovery to Aiden regarding what he's being charged for, how it somehow rises to the level of witness intimidation, the things that he's done. They have not proven it in any of their documents, and it's basically just his words taken out of context. So that is, and it's protected speech. And I believe it was three individuals. So I think it was Colin, Chris, and Albert, and then Jen McCabe, who had tried to get restraining orders on Turtle Boy. And in civil court, they were denied because it's all protected speech. But then yet, somehow they found this witness intimidation statute, and they're using it to as a weapon to silence Turtle Boy. That's the only reason. And it's sickening. All right, so he was arraigned in Superior Court. They lifted the stay away conditions. So he's on a high December 22nd, and then he has a side piece, or an ex-side piece, who is still trying to bother him and whatever. She's being coerced by the special prosecutor, Ken Mello, in his case, and Brian Tully, the individual who arrested him. This side piece woman is in cahoots with these two individuals trying to get Aiden arrested. So they made up some bogus BS charges. She somehow coerced Aiden to get to her apartment. And then he didn't want to go inside the apartment, but eventually, you know, she coerced him to go in. They were just like talking out in the lobby. And then finally they go in and whatever, a fight ensues. God, my dog always has to lay right on the laptop. Hold on a second. All right. I think I was talking about, so on December 23rd, 24th, she gets Aiden to come over to her apartment. He does. He tries to stay in the lobby. She coerces him to come into her apartment where there are no cameras. And that's when she proceeds to argue with him, fight with him, blah, blah, blah. She wouldn't let him leave. All this stuff was going on, but he never laid a hand on her. He leaves. Finally, he leaves in the morning. He gets into a car accident because he was so tired because she made him stay up with him all night long. And then later, he finds out that he has some new charges. He's got a temporary restraining order now, which has now been a 1 year. It's turned into a 1 year since. But at that time, it was a temporary restraining order. He gets charged for DV and A and B. So that's on like December 24th-ish. And the timing of when the charges were issued is suspect because they were done at like 11 p.m. at night. So, and you have Brian Tully and Ken Mello texting the girl saying, get him in the apartment and all this stuff. So they're trying to get all those text messages, but they were hand fed only some of them. So they need to get the whole data extraction. Anyway, so he has a bolo. He gets arrested. or is arrested. He turns himself in, though. So that was, I think it was December 24th. So Christmas Eve, he spends, you know, his Christmas morning with his kids, and then he goes and he turns himself into prison. I really think that the individuals who colluded to get him to go to prison wanted him there for the holidays. I really believe that. I think that that was their attempt. And because he had a win in the Supreme Court, they had to come at him and take him down. That's my opinion. I think that they are so lust-driven with, like, power and control, and all they want is to win at no matter what cost, even if it means justice does not prevail. Makes no sense to me in the Commonwealth there, but whatever. So he's arraigned December 27th. Bail is revoked. He's in prison. He spends 60 days in jail. On January 8th, there's a hearing with the so-called victim. The restraining order is extended to 1 year, even though she was caught in multiple lies on the stand. Just goes to show how easy it is to sue people, charge people with things. You don't need a whole lot of evidence, apparently. All right, so Karen Reed's phone seized January 24th. This was when they thought that Aiden and Karen, because they had talked in prison, that they were colluding or conspiring to witness intimidation, which is so dumb. But they were trying to get her on that. That never came to anything. But they took her phone. They took his phones. Again, they've taken his laptop, his computer, all of his like work product, which is his notes and everything, his sources that have information about the cops. All that information the cops still have. They haven't given it back. And they've asked for it back. All they need to do is make a mirrored copy of it. Not a mirrored, not a reversed copy, but a copy of it. And then they can give him back the physical computer. That's all they need to do. But they refuse. They won't give him anything back. That's not really important. These were just things that I knew that were coming up. But anyways, so search warrant was unsealed on January 31st, a 31-page warrant trying to connect Reed and Carney in a conspiracy to intimidate witnesses and taint the jury pool was released. And these people are something else. They really are. And since all these dates, we've had some more hearings, but most of the time it's just pushed back or they have not been turning over the discovery that they keep asking for. And this is a continuing problem with Turtle Boy and the indictments that he's facing. All right. So on that note, I wanted to leave us with this note. The quote that I enjoyed very much. Makes me think, by Harry S. Truman. Once government is committed to the principle of silencing the voice of opposition, it has only one way to go, and that is down the path of increasingly repressed measures until it becomes a source of terror to all its citizens and creates a country where everyone lives in fear. And that is what's happening in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. They are trying to silence the people. They aren't letting the people's needs and concerns be heard. And they keep going to these repressive measures to silence people, to stop people. They had the 200-foot buffer zone during trial so that they could silence the people of the town. It's been very apparent that the town just wants, or not the town, the Commonwealth wants it all to go away, wants it to be quiet, just wants to sweep everything under the rug, which is apparently what they've been doing there for centuries, and nobody's being accountable for what's going on there, and it's time. for accountability to start taking place. And the people, there were like hundreds of people that turned out today for the Karen Reed hearing that lasted 2 minutes. And then there were about 20 people most on the other side, because now they're starting to recruit people on the other side, which is so stupid. But okay. I mean, they have a right to be there, but I don't know why they want to be when they're so outnumbered, and it just makes them look foolish. But that's on them. That's their right to look foolish. They want to. So let me know what you guys think of this case, of Karen Reed and her legal team, of the judge. What do you think of her just ignoring, sweeping under the rug, the whole idea of there's 5 jurors now that have come forward? Nothing talked about on that. I mean, I know it wasn't on the agenda, I guess, but she still could have addressed it. She didn't. She's just like, yeah, you'll probably just be appealing my decision. Whatever. So we already know now that she's going to deny their motion. Just so stupid. I don't know what their remedies would be after that, but there's got to be something that could be done. I would think appealing it somehow to a higher court would need to take place if Judge Cannone just outright dismisses their right to even talk to the jury or to, you know, bring them in and ask them, were you all unanimous on counts 1 and 3? Did you reach a verdict on any of the counts? That's all you had to ask. But no, she just rushed them out of there and said bye now, and they didn't even have a chance to say anything. So very unfortunate. This whole situation is unfortunate, and it's mostly unfortunate for Karen and just the justice system in general, because it's pretty poor showing of what our system is like. If someone from another country watched this trial as an example of what our country is like, they'd be scared to come here. So yeah, I'll leave it at that. Let me know what you guys think. Thank you so much for being here. Please hit the like button on your way out. Don't forget to subscribe, and I will see you in the next one. Bye now.
If you've been impacted by a true crime and would like your story told in your own words, or if you or someone you know has been wrongfully convicted or accused of a crime, please write to crimeincourtchannel@gmail.com.